الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء المرسلين وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Let me begin by just conveying my mubaraki to all mu'mineen and all Muslims on the 17th of Ramadan, which is the day when the Badr was fought and won by Muslims. The Battle of Badr is a turning point in the history of Islam. It is so important that now every person who participated in Badr is known as Badriyun. Whenever he would die, the historians mention, for example, so-and-so died in this year and he participated in the Badr. So that was 17th of Ramadan, and today is 17th of Ramadan. Now we go to Dua Makan wa Akhlaq, and now passage number 15. Imam says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Allahumma inna maghfirataka bafattu, wa ila afwika kasattu, wa ila tajawuzika ashtakattu, wa bifadlika wasiktu, wa laysa indi ma yujibu li maghfirataka, wa la fi amali ma astahiku bihi afwika, wa ma li ba'da an hakamta ala nafsi illa fadlaka. It's quite interesting passage. You know, we don't realize that when we do dua, when we seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we seek pardon from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's not that automatically we deserve for that. No. Like, for example, no, istighfar is known as pleading, no, for forgiveness in the court of Allah. That's what istighfar is. So even, for example, if I go to the court, any court, for example, if I have a case, then I have to, say, example, somebody wants a parole, right? Say, okay, I would like to just go out and be released earlier. Then they look at the record, that how much he was disciplined, how did he behave during the time when he was in prison. So in the same way, for example, Imam says, when I look at myself, when I judge myself, when I look internally, when I see my deeds, I don't find myself deserving to really get this thing. It's only because, Allah, you are kind and merciful, you are full of bounty. That is the only reason I do that. So this is a very important point, because sometimes some of us, when we do mustahab amal, we think that we are doing ihsan on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that as if we are favoring Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what Imam says, Allahumma illa maghfirtaka wafattu. Oh Allah, I have come to your forgiveness. Now, wafad is, for example, wafud is known as the delegation, right? So I just come as a delegation, you know, to your court to seek forgiveness. Wa ila afrika kasattu. And also I have just going straight to your pardon. Af is pardon. You know? I'm trying to just seek your pardon directly. Wa ila tajawuzika ishtakattu. Now, and also I yearn for your tajawuz. Tajawuz is forbearance or overlooking, for example. Tajawuz comes, forbearance is when Allah knows our mistakes, our sins, our disobedience. In spite of that, He overlooks those things and gives us. So, I'm mushtaq. Ishtakastu, that means I'm mushtaq. No, I yearn for your overlooking. Wa bifadlika wa thiktu. And also, you know, I trust you based on your bounty, you know, because of your bounty, I think. Then he says, وَلَيْسَ عِنْدِي مَا يُوجِبُ لِي مَغْفِرَتَكَ. I do not have anything that I really can say that, okay, Ya Allah, forgive me. I don't have any kind of assets or any kind of sarwat, right? وَلَيْسَ عِنْدِي مَا يُوجِبُ لِي مَغْفِرَتَكَ. No, that I deserve any kind of affair. وَلَا فِي عَمَلِي مَا أَسْتَيْكُ بِي أَفْرِكَ. Nor, even if I look at my deeds. And this is important, because remember we have been saying this thing also yesterday, we discussed about istiqlal al-khair, istiqsar al-shar, right? Istiqlal al-khair, that means any good you do, just diminish it. Consider it is nothing compared to what I'm supposed to do, what others do. Istiqsar al-shar, that means if anything wrong which I do, I should not have done it, because somebody who is in a worse position, but he did not commit that sin. Now, for example, just now, that you know, we are living here in the West, we got all the facilities. In spite of that, if somebody, for example, does not give zakah, does not give homes, does not give sadaqah, does not give charity, does not help others, does not take care of, you know, family members, then what kind of excuse you got? No? So when I look at my deeds, I don't find that I deserve, you know, وَلَا فِي أَمَلِي مَا أَسْتَيْكُ بِنَفْكَ. When I look at my deeds, I don't find that I, based on my deeds, I deserve any pardon. وَمَا لِي بَعْدَ أَنْ حَكَمْتُ عَلَى نَفْسِي إِلَّا فَضْلُكَ. Then he says, when I judge my soul, when I look internally at myself, I see that on my behalf, judge nothing but just your bounty. It is only because of your fadl, that I can approach you. وَصَلِّ عَلَىٰ مُحَمَّدٍ. So bless Muhammad and his al, وَتَفَضَّلْ عَلَيَّ. And just be kind on me, be kind upon me, or just bestow your bounty on me. So here are those words. Maghfirat is forgiveness, right? We always ask, for example, between two sajda, we say, Astaghfirullah Rabbi wa atubu ilayh. I seek forgiveness of my Lord and I turn to him. Or for example, after namaz, we say istighfar, right? Also in it is said that the believers are the one who do istighfar early in the morning. Sir is the last one third part of the night. The Quran says that no believers are those who do istighfar in the time of Sir, right? So we do istighfar often, but keep in mind that just by asking istighfar does not automatically mean that we deserve it. No? Afwa is pardon. For example, in Tahajjud Salat, it's al-afwa, al-afwa, al-afwa. We pardon. Allah, just pardon me because I've done so many mistakes and so many things that I need your pardon, right? And that's why it is mustahab to say 300 times. Although, if you are running short time, just say 10-10, if you don't have time. Or if you are tired, for example, if you don't feel like having a long witr, so then you can just say 10-10, al-afwa, al-afwa. But otherwise, it's mustahab to say 300 times, right? Tajawuz, forbearance, overlooking. For example, there's a beautiful dua. I don't know how many of you recite this thing. This is a dua recommended by the 8th Imam in the kunut of Tahajjud Salat. Rabbi ghfir warham wa tajawaz amma ta'lamu innaka antal azul ajal al-akram, right? In our book of Tahajjud Salat, which I showed you the other day, and also the app, we've got app of Tahajjud Salat both on iPhone and also Google. If you download, then these duas are there. Rabbi ghfir warham, Allah forgive me, have mercy on me, wa tajawaz amma ta'lamu, and just overlook about what you know about me, right? Just, you know so many things about me, just overlook. So this is tajawaz. Fadl is bounty and grace over and above what we have earned. Fadl is something that means not what I deserve, whatever, because something which Allah gives over and above, than what I deserve, what I have earned, right? So that is fadl. So, but now the question comes, when does maghfirat get rejected? Now there are so many reasons, but we have got limited time. So I'll just share with you only one hadith. In Al-Kafi, there's an interesting hadith there that Nabi Dawood received a wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah said to Nabi Dawood, go to my servant whose name is Daniel. Just tell him that when he disobeyed, I forgave him. When he disobeyed for the second time, I forgave him. When he disobeyed for the third time, I forgave him. But if you were to disobey me for the fourth time consecutively, I will not forgive you. So do you see this thing? That sometimes when we commit sins, be careful. Take a break. Just don't go on doing it. Continuously. Because sooner or later a time would come that our istighfar will not be accepted, right? Or for example, tajawuz. What are the things which are overlooked and not overlooked? For example, Imam Ali says, reward goodness and overlook the offense. If it is not a breach in religion or undermining of the authority of Islam. So if somebody, for example, does an offense, if it's not a breach of religion or undermining the authority of Islam, then you overlook that, right? Reward the goodness and overlook the offense. But for provided it is not a breach of religion or undermining of the authority of Islam. And that is why, for example, mujtahids are telling us that be careful whom you listen to, because that people sometimes can also mislead you, right? Because they are now undermining the authority of Islam or they are being a breach of Islam. Now, Ramadhan Islam has a beautiful hadith, says, whoever exceeds the bounds of their love for Amir al-Mu'mineen into worship. Imam Ali was a great person, there is no doubt in it. He is the second most person with fazilat after Rasulullah to walk on this earth. Rasulullah is the most perfect person, we believe, and after that, Imam Ali. So there is no doubt that he was great. But then we raise him so much that we start doing ibadat of him. Ali Ilahi, for example, there's a group Ali Ilahi that means people believe Ali is a god. So Imam says, whoever exceeds the bounds of their love for Amir Mu'mineen into worship of him is indeed among those who incur Allah's wrath. In fact, Imam says, فَهُوَ مِنْ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَمِنْ الظَّالِمِ. So that means every time we say in namaz, right? اَهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ. Not the path of those on whom we got your anger, you are angry with them, and those who have gone astray. So Imam says, a person who admires Ali so much that he starts worshipping Ali, instead Ali as a god, na'udhu billah, then that is from those who are min al-maghdubi alayhim wa al-dhalin. These are the people about whom Allah is angry and they've gone astray, right? So this is just some of the examples. Of course, there can be many examples about tajawuz and about no istighfar, not accepted. I see in myself or my actions, yes, I'm just summarizing that if you look at this passage, I see in myself or my actions are filled with evil. So I need to draw from His grace to benefit from His divine bounties. Otherwise, I'm doomed. That means if I look at my actions, if I look at myself, I see that no, I don't have any kind of what reasons to believe that automatically my istighfar will be accepted. But just because of the divine grace, fadl of Allah, that I'm hoping that my istighfar, my du'as, and my munajat will inshallah be accepted. We go to today, as we said, it is the 17th of Ramadan. It is the day when Badr was fought and won. It is one of the first battles, major, but it was won. And that was a turning point in the history of Islam. Right? So there is a dua which we usually recite on the day of Ashura, because Shaykh al-Mufid in Kitab al-Ishad mentions this dua is on the day of Ashura. If the fourth Imam is the one who is a Rawi, he's reporting that when the cavalry began to approach Al-Hussein, that means when the enemy came with all the soldiers and horses, and they came, at that time Imam raised his hand and said the dua. So I'm sure that many of you do recite this dua on the day of Ashura, but there is a book Maqtal Hussein by Abdul Razak Mukarram. It is one of the Maqtal, that means book about the events of Karbala, which is reliable. I remember in 1990, I went to Qom for 3 months to do research. One of the research was, which are the reliable books one can use for the events of Karbala, because sometimes people make so many stories. So one of the books which was I was recommended at that time by scholars, was Maqtal Mukarram by Abdul Razak Mukarram al-Musawi. In that book, there is a note which says that this is the same dua which also Prophet recited on the day of Badr. And that is why I thought I'll just share with this dua. It is available also in the book. If you see the Amal of Ashura, you'll get this dua. But look at the dua, so beautifully, right? And this is because at the time of Ashura, when Imam is now surrounded, you can see the soldiers are coming, but see the trust of trust Allah, Imam has in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma anta thikati fi kulli karbin wa rajai fi kulli shidda. Oh Allah, it is you in whom I trust amid all grief, and you are my hope amid all the violence. You see, so Allah is a trust, and also Allah is, you can see hope under all circumstances. Fi kulli, you can see fi kulli karbin, wa fi kulli shidda. Now those who know Arabic, it is not qualified. It says kulli, without any case, under all kind of circumstances, oh Allah, you are my trust. Under all difficulties, you are my hope. Anta li fi kulli, again, fi kulli amrin, nazala bi thikatun wa uddatun, right? Again, Imam says that you are, that you are my trust and provision in everything that happens to me. No matter how much the heart may seem to weaken it, or trickery may seem to diminish my hope in it. In spite of the thing that because Imam knew this is the early day and early in the morning of Ashura, is now the enemy was just gathering to attack Imam. At that time, Imam knew, right, what is going to come, because Prophet had given him the prophecy, was there, right? So at that time also, you can see Imam knew that there'll be so much kind of trickery, schemes, everything will be done today just to get rid of me and my family and my soldiers. He knew, Imam knew. But you can see his trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is it, that we are just now going through a pandemic. People are facing a lot of challenges. Of course, we must follow all the advice given to us by health authorities. But besides that, you know, we being, for example, locked or isolated, or we cannot go and meet our family and our children and all those things, or we cannot go to centers or other things. Yes, it's not easy. Some of us really are depressed. But keep in mind that we as believers, you know, in Allah and in Ahlul Bayt, look at Imam Hussein. What can be a day worse day than the day of Ashura? At least our day is nothing compared to what Imam Hussein's day was on the day of Ashura. At that time, you can see his hope, his trust, you know, his thika in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was at all so firm, right? It did not move him. He said, even the enemy will rejoice, for example. I know that today the enemy rejoiced. We also say, for example, right, in Sayyat Ashura, that this is the day when Banu Umayyah were just happy, right? They used to rejoice this day. And they used to start giving people, on the day of Ashura, Banu Umayyah used to start giving people free things, like every day on the day of Eid, right? They would do that, just because that is the day when Imam Hussein was killed. So Imam Hussein, I knew that this was going to happen. But he did not at all, you know, lose his trust and hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We pray to Allah that may Allah also give us tawfiq, that we are able to keep our faith in Allah, you know, strong, and in spite of all the challenges, we will not move. Yesterday there was a question, before I take any questions, yesterday there was a question regarding Radd Mazalim, right? So I did some homework and I prepared this slide. I'm not going to read it. You can just read yourself. So these are, what is the meaning of the mazalim? Also, how do you disperse the mazalim? This is based on Ayatollah Sistani's question answer, Persian. If you take the Persian site of Ayatollah Sistani, sistani.org, if you go to Farsi site, question answer number 0927, these are the question of the mazalim and what he explained. There were two questions. One is, can we give to, it is necessary to obtain the permission of marja. And secondly, what is the meaning of the mazalim? And also at the end, I have quoted, there's a beautiful book by Sheikh Abbas Kumi, known as Manasil Akhira. Manasil Akhira, that means the stations after we die, what are the stations we are going through, Berserk, and for example. So this is known as Manasil Akhira. And then there is a chapter on Berserk. If you go to the chapter, there are five stories. He talks about people who went through Berserk, right? Chapter, incident number four, story number four, there's a mention of also Radd Mazalim, that somebody, for example, had died, and appointed so and so person to pray, fast, perform Hajj, give zakat, and Radd Mazalim on his behalf. You see? So you can see some great people also used to not only give what wasiyat, that somebody will pay my khums, somebody will pay my, say my namaz, and my, for example, Hajj and everything. They would also include Radd Mazalim. So it's such an important thing that you can see it is in the will of a person that knows this person responsible to also pay Radd Mazalim. So Radd Mazalim is something very important. Any questions?
Thank you, Sheikh. Just remember to come off mute and feel free to ask any questions you have. There are two questions here so far in the chat. One is, battles were not fought during Ramadan. Why did the Battle of Badr take place on the 17th?
Yes, maybe this is, this Battle of Badr was fought right in the beginning when it was in Medina. So could be that it was still the order of fasting had not come. And secondly, don't forget that most of the battles were not offensive, they were defensive. So when the enemy attacks you, he doesn't see Ramadan or not, right? For example, the eighth Imam, is a very hadith which every scholar mentions on the first night of Muharram, that when Rayyan goes to meet eighth Imam, so Imam talks about what happened in Karbala. One of the things he says, interestingly, he says that Muharram has been the month which is a sacred month. There are 4 months which are sacred, right? Rajab. Zilkada, Zilhajja, and Muharram. So he said Muharram has been sacred, whereby even people of Jahiliyyah before Islam, they would not attack. But this Ummah, how much unfair they were that they attacked the grandson of the Prophet in the month of Muharram, right? So the enemy doesn't see whether it's Ramadan or not, right?
Thank you. Another question here is, Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh, and Jazakallah khair for the morning sessions. Besides those that worship Imam Ali alayhi salam, as God, what are the other groups that are part of the Zalim group?
Well, there can be so many. I have to do the research on it. But of course, no. For example, here we are talking about those who will not be overseen, right? That means their action will not be overseen. So consider imam as to worship. That means, of course, if somebody does shirk to that extent, you know, when we say iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in, keep in mind that our ibadat is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't involve anybody in the ibadat. So, for example, sometimes we are saying our namaz, and suddenly somebody comes and we improve our namaz, you know, our stature changes, our makhraj changes, you know. That should not be the case. You know, people do exactly the opposite. When you are an imam and go to masjid to lead the prayer, at that time you will be very simple and fast, right? Because you'll take consideration of people who are there. But when you are saying namaz at home, now say long surahs, now say long sajda, now do long ruku, right? Don't impress people. Now your ibadah is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So keep in mind that no, when we do ibadah, it's only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Certain things Allah will not forgive, and one of them is shirk. Shirk is something which should not be forgiven at all, not at all overlooked. So saying prayers for others to show off, these are all, you know, you will see there is a very good, there's a book we mentioned earlier, 40 hadiths by Ayatollah Khomeini. Within that, you'll find that one hadith discusses about, you know, what riya, about show off, you know? And then he gives different kind of stages of riya. One of them, he says that, you know, when we do ibadat, to show off is also a shirk, you know? Is a stage of shirk. So keep that in mind. You
know? There's one sort of a clarification on this last question as well. Can we read Ali, Ya Ali, Tasbih? Is that allowed based off this discussion?
Yeah, of course, Ya Ali is fine as long as we know that Ali was a servant of Allah and he also did ibadat. Imam Ali, you know, did namaz and ruku and sajda the way we do. So Ya Ali, as long as no Ya Ali is mentioned, because Prophet also mentioned Ya Ali, we are following about Sirat of the Prophet, that's okay. That we consider him as a great person through whom our du'as get accepted, is fine. But as long as we don't consider him as a divine, we consider him as somebody great, there is no doubt in it. Somebody who was holy, somebody who was masoom, somebody who was very close to the Prophet, somebody who was the best, you know, contributor in Islam, yes, but not as a divine.
Very good. One question regarding the youth. Go ahead, sorry, go ahead, please.
Hi, assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam.
I have a question here. When we pray namaz salatul walidain, is it like our niyat is only for our parents, or we can include kul mu'minin or minat?
Yes, if you can do that, but keep in mind that basic is for the walidain. As I said earlier in one of the lectures, that if you want to do include for kul mu'minat, the best thing is namaz hadi mayat. Because walidain is actually for your parents. Keep in mind that there is something you have to give to your parents. So this is the least thing. And don't involve others in that. When you, for example, make a gift for, just only yesterday was a Mother's Day, right? So when you want to take something for your mother, it is for your mother only. Don't now include, that it's for my mother, also for my aunt, also for, no. This is special because my mother is a special person. So namaz hadi walidain is that special gift for the parents. You want to remember other marumin, just recite namaz hadi mayyat.
Hadi mayyat, okay. Okay, thank you. And another one, like when we say salawat, we say Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, and then sometimes Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. So what's the difference between Muhammadin wa Muhammad?
Yeah, this is a tajweed. Tajweed, once you learn the tajweed rule, it comes Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. If you say Muhammad, that's fine. You can pause wa ali Muhammad. If you don't pause, then say Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. So if you decide to pause Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, then you can say wa ali Muhammad. Now, because in Arabic, there's a rule that you always pause with Sakin. It is actually Muhammadin. If you see, in Salawat, how it's written, it's Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin, right? But if you pause, it becomes Muhammadin because Muhammad. So Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. But make sure you pause. But you can't say Allahumma salli Muhammad wa al-Muhammad. If you say Muhammad wa al-Muhammad without pausing, then it's wrong tajweed wise. It is Muhammadin wa al-Muhammad. It's not Muhammad. If you say Muhammad, then pause. Even for a few seconds, but pause. Allahumma salli Muhammad wa al-Muhammad. But if you don't pause in the sense Allahumma salli Muhammadin wa al-Muhammad. So it's a tajweed, the rule of tajweed. One has to know what to read. Nowadays, of course, because you can just go also online and just look at the rules of tajweed and how I can improve my reading. There are lessons online available, and there are also programs available to teach you the tajweed. No?
Okay, thank you.
Before we go to the next question, there's a request if you could just go to the previous slide. They were people still going through that one. And the next question is, Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh. My question is that for the youth of today, many of them don't have very strong trust in Allah because they don't have a strong belief in the unseen. How do we strengthen that belief in the unseen as a vital part of our belief?
Yes, Iman ilm al-ghayb is very important. It's a very central point. This is because today's youth is so much believing that the way science believes, right? That whatever you can see or feel or you can see around you, that is only your belief. No? But there are so many things. Just take this, what can be a better example than this virus, right? You can see, who can see the virus? Who has seen coronavirus? With our eyes, we don't even see it. It is just that the scientists believe that it is there. It is so small, right? It is so small. I'm forgetting the weight. No, it's, I think 10,000 part of a gram, or so small. They say and they believe it. But you and me cannot see it. But you can see the havoc it has wrecked, right? Today it has infected 4 million people, right? So when a coronavirus, which is such a small thing, which we've not even seen, can bring such a kind of disturbance in the whole world, imagine about the power of Allah, which of course we not see. So not everything just can be seen is right. Even we have not seen this virus, but we feel. No? And there are so many things, for example, even the pain. No, we don't see the pain, but we just feel it's just internal, right? Or for example, there's a beautiful example that in Quran, when Nabi Ibrahim was asked to sacrifice Ismail, and Ismail said, yes, go ahead. No, Satajidun Ishaq no Sabin, go ahead, my father, since you are a prophet of God and you have seen the dream, go ahead with what you've been asked. No? So then Ibrahim makes Ismail just lie down, and he himself makes a blindfold and takes the knife and about to slaughter. He was about to slaughter his son, right? And immediately Allah sends a ram and he's just saved, right? After the incident, Quran says, Salamu ala Ibrahim, peace be on Ibrahim. My question is, if the slaughter would have continued, if Ibrahim was asked to slaughter the son, who would be harmed more, Ismail or Ibrahim? Would not Ismail be harmed more? Because his neck could be slaughtered. But Allah sends salam to Ibrahim. Why? Because although Ismail would have seen that physical pain, but more than that, the pain of a father to see a young son being slaughtered by himself, that is even more difficult, right? And that's why you can see Allah sends salam to Ibrahim, not to Ismail. Now Allah could have sent salam to Ismail, that Ismail, you are so brave that you are ready to sacrifice. But there are certain things, although we don't see it, right? And there are so many examples which can be seen to see that things which are not seen, but they are reality, right? And that way, of course, once we take one by one steps, realize that, of course, the power of Allah is there in faith. But it's a discussion on its own, right? This is very important that our youth should always be encouraged to take classes on creed, Islamic belief. What we learn in madrasa is very minimum. And at that time, when we learn madrasa, we were very young. So we are taught according to our level. But as we grow, and as our understanding increases, or comprehension increases, it's very important. Every son and daughter of community who goes to the college and university must take classes on creed, on Islamic belief. If you don't do that, you can be misled by your professors, because there is so much godlessness, right? You can see just now, I was mentioning this thing earlier also, that this coronavirus, we see the news every day, but in all this news, you will not find the word God at all. That God will make us go out of it. You will not find it at all. because the newscaster is not allowed. If the newscaster uses the word God, he'll be just fired, right? So there's so much godlessness there. So we need to go through our classes on Aqaid and strengthen our belief.
Good examples there, thank you. Another question regarding the discussion on sins and forgiveness. After the fourth repeat of the sin, should we lose hope in maghfirah, forgiveness?
No, we'll not lose, of course, hope in maghfirah. We'll never lose hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? Because losing the hope in Allah is itself a sin. No? We'll not do that. But you realize that the whole idea of this hadith is that you can see how grave it is. That Allah is forgiving us, Allah is overlooking us, Allah is, for example, not punishing us. But once a person has that audacity to disobey once, second time, third time, you know, and still continues. So how much audacious a person can be? You know, we say his jurat, no? Himmat kya thi aavi gayne se kune khuda ni na farmani kare. You know, we say in Gujarat, you know. So keep that in mind. The whole idea of that hadith is that, you know, sometimes just put a stop, break, you know, in wrong things and look at it. And this is the best time. Month of Ramadan is the best time because we are fasting. And as we are fasting, you know, we are not eating and drinking because of obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah, somebody sent me a message only a few days ago. A certain person talks abusive language, you know, while he's fasting, but you know, when he gets angry, he talks so much abusive language. I said, what has he learned from Ramadan? You know, what Ramadan is not changing, because if you be abusive in the month of Ramadan also, it just defeats the whole purpose, right? The essence of fasting goes away.
Okay, I know we're running a little bit over time, but there's just two or three more questions that are a little bit off topic. But
today's not a weekend. Go ahead, yeah.
Okay, let's give it a try. Can Waladain Salat be recited in the morning after Fajr, or it has to be done between Maghrib and Isha only?
No. Waladain Salat, Sheikh Abbas Kumi mentions anytime. There is no time for Waladain Namaz. You can anytime you can do it. You know, because I saw in the books only somebody asked me. Because on the first 5 nights when I did tafsir of Surah An-Nur, the last tafsir, the last session was what I discussed the slide on Namaz Hadi Waladain. So somebody sent me a question that when can be recited. So I did some homework and I found that Namaz Hadi Waladain can recite it anytime. You know, but you can recite between Maghrib and Isha, after Isha, or anytime. But there's no mention there that when you should recite.
Very good. Is Namaz Hadi Waladain and Maghfirata Waladain the same prayer, or are they different?
I'm not sure aware of the Maghfirata Waladain, so maybe the questioner can send me email and send me the method, you know, because what I know is Namaz Hadi Waladain. If there is Namaz Maghfirata Waladain, then sorry, I'm not aware of it, and you'll excuse my ignorance now.
No problem. Well, I think the other question we have here is, which namaz is better, namaz-e-washat-e-kabr or namaz-hadi-e-mayit for the first night for the deceased?
Yeah, namaz-e-washat is for the relatives. If you are a relative of the marhum, or if you are very close to somebody and the person has died in your city, then namaz-e-washat is for them. Otherwise, the rest of us, for example, we get the news that some so-and-so has died in, I'm in Toronto, somebody died in Dar es Salaam, somebody's died in Tanga, somebody died in London, then namaz-e-hadi-e-mayit.
Thank you. Any other questions for people online want to ask? Just unmute yourself.
There's not a question, but a comment that our one of the volunteers, very dedicated volunteer, Ali Jafri and his wife, elderly, both are positive for coronavirus, COVID-19. So just a request for prayer for their recovery. They are in good spirits. Both are in hospital, and just a request of their recovery. Dua.
Thank you very much, Mehdi bhai. Because this session which we are having is extension of Fajr sessions in Toronto, and this Ali bhai is regular. Now, Sayyid Ali Muhammad Abbas Jafri attends morning sessions regularly on Sundays and Saturdays. So he has been taken ill, and his wife also positive COVID. Now. So please pray for their recovery and also recovery of all mu'mineen who are suffering on account of this sickness. Again, inshallah, we'll see you tomorrow. Please don't forget each other in your du'as, inshallah.
Hassan, thank you, Shaykh. See you tomorrow, inshallah, everyone. Take care. Good office.